Okay, welcome everybody. So again, welcome to our next session of the Dynamo Express series. And again today, Peter Reithofer from 4A in Engineering will give a talk. This time is about part two. Last week we have seen him talk about modeling isotropic thermoplastics, and today he's going to talk about anisotropic modeling of thermoplastics. So with that being said, Peter, I hand over to you, and you are ready, Peter?
Yeah, thank you, Mike. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So, okay, sorry for the technical issue. We are trying a new system. As you can see, we wanted to improve to have more personal contact. It's a pleasure to have you hopefully again at our meeting today on the anisotropic modeling. The outlook would be I want to give a short introduction to our company for those who were not couldn't join last time. I also want to short to wrap up what we have talked last week. Then I want to go into the new topic, short fiber reinforced and long fiber reinforced thermoplastics and composite, which material models are available. I would like to give you a rough overview how you can use these material models in LS-DYNE and how you can generate these material cards too. So if you have any questions during this webinar, please just ask. It's no problem to interrupt me. So it would be a pleasure for questions are welcome. So start with, I want to give you a short overview about our company. So as you can see here, that's the facility of the 4A Group, the middle of the mountains in Austria. Our focus is plastics and simulation, testing equipment and lateral products. And we have different business units. Perhaps you know our sister company for active systems, which is developing testing facilities for active vehicle safeties. Typically, you can see these dummies, which are put on the ground to test the sensors. My name is Peter Reithofer, and I'm responsible for the 4A engineering, and we are dealing with engineering of plastics, simulation of them. Therefore, we developed a lots of products to better predict the behavior of plastics in the simulation. We are offering lots of services. One of our service, what we are offering, is material characterization. So typically, customers can come to us and send us some pellets, some granular, some raw material. We will mold these materials, make samples out of it, test it, and finally send back a validated material part for LS-DYNE, for instance. Therefore, we are using our products. On the one side, you can see we have software products and also hardware product. The hardware product, this is the so-called Impetus, which is mainly intended to do dynamic testing, so high-speed testing to get material properties at this strain rates around 50 per second. And we have software solutions which helps you to make material cards, so from the test to the validated material. To the tested to the moment, please. So I give the micro a little bit more here. So bring the test to the validated material card, and then we have additional products which we need today, especially for the anisotropic materials, where we can calculate the composite properties by the known parts like resin and fiber. And also can do the mapping from the process simulation into the structure simulation. These products are intended for different materials, as you can see. Last week we mainly were talking about the thermoplastics, and today we will talk about the fiber reinforced plastics and the composites. A short summary of last week I would like to give. So we were looking at different material models, especially for the thermoplastics, which have an isotropic behavior. So we were especially looking on MATSAMP and MATSAMP light, which is possible to have a yield surface which is not constant, which can be different in under pressure behavior. And also we can use viscoplasticity and use a plastic Poisson ratio which is needed for this class of materials. We were also looking on different failure models, and that case we had a look on integrated models and especially on mud at erosion. I also like to mention that we got some questions after the last webinar. We should follow up with additional information on this mud, on these new features, mud at damage DM and mud at damage Gizmo. I'm sure we will have opportunity for further webinar at the DynaExpress, but there is also the opportunity in future. Then beginning of July, we will offer our Valimat summer school, different topics. And the first week will be an introduction week. And the second week will be advanced topics week, where we'll focus how to generate material cards for MATSAMP, and also how to generate material cards for anisotropic behavior, which is mainly the talk of today also. So, I would like to invite you for those meetings, and it would be a pleasure to welcome you here for these webinars, which are also free of charge. So please have a look on our website and just register if you're interested in. So now we go back to the topic of the material glass, the fiber reinforced plastics. So if we look at this material glass, has typically about 20 to 50% mass percent fibers in it. Fiber lengths can be around 200 micrometer for short fibers, perhaps 1000 to 2000 micrometer for long fiber reinforced materials. These are typical materials are used in injection molding, and like a PB-LGF 30 or PS6-GF45, that's a typical material glasses which are used here in Kammann. So what will be the outline for this material glass? First of all, I would like to give you some short motivation why we do that, why we need some special material models for this glass. What is the influence of the manufacturing for the injection molding? What material model approaches are available? Then I want to go in detail in the material characterization of this anisotropic behavior. And finally, I would like to show you a case study how we could improve. So, motivation, current situation. As a standard material model, simulation engineers like to use MAT24. In case of anisotropic materials, perhaps they make a research on it and they will have a material card for highly orientated fibers and transversal orientated fiber orientation. So perhaps you have two different or three different material cards averaged, which can be used. And if you then use this material card in the simulation, then it could happen that if you make such a test, this is a sleeve, a cable sleeve, which is tested in a drop tower. So there's a fall void, it's going down and it fails. As you can see, it fails here in these areas. And if you use these isotropic material cards, we will end up in a total different failure behavior. So as you see, we are failing in this outside because here we have the highest stresses, as you assume, and the isotropic behavior will finally fail here. So let's have a closer look at that. So in the processing here, we have a backdoor, which is filled. Typical simulation would be a mode filling simulation with different injection gates. If you look closer in these areas, we will find we have areas where we have an averaged fiber orientation, which is clear because it's more a blade behavior, or we have more a highly orientated area where the fibers are orientated along this struct, like if you mold the injection, if you mold the tensile bar. So we see locally different fibers have different orientation and also orientation grade, which lead us in different mechanical behavior. So if you have a look at, for instance, the Young's modulus over the fiber orientation for different fiber contents, we will see that with increasing fiber orientation, we get to higher Young's modulus, which means that we have here, we are weaker this area than in this region in this direction. So we are locally highly influenced on the manufacturing process. Now have a closer look at the material behavior itself. We did some bending tests and compared what happens. In that case, a dynamic bending and static bending tests were conducted. And if we look, for instance, for dynamic test for different direction and different fiber contents of the same material class, we will see that if we cut out the sample in mold direction, we are stiffer and break earlier. And if you cut out the sample transversal to the injection direction, we will be weaker and have a later failure behavior. If we have less fiber in it, we also are weaker with higher fiber content. With increase in the fiber content, the stiffness increases and the failure displacement decreases. So we directly see the influence which is coming from the fiber. On the other side, if we look on the strain rate, so if we do a static and a dynamic test, so if we do a static and a dynamic test here, then we see that this influence is coming from the strain rate dependency of the matrix. We see the same influence in the longitudinal direction as well as the transversal direction. And same will be if we look at different temperatures for the same material, we will see as the thermoplastic has a high influence on the temperature, we see with a lower temperature, we get more brittle and stiffer, and with a higher temperature, we get more ductile and weaker. So that's our main topics. We have influence coming from the fiber, and we have influences coming from the matrix. So let's look at different material models in LS-DYNA. Sorry, do you have any questions meanwhile? If not, then I will go further. So if you look in LS-DYNA on different material models, we can look on the first few on macro scale models on constitutive flows, and I already told about the quick and dirty approach in that case with MAT24, just making, for instance, an average material cut. But we also can then perhaps look at more material models which are intended for this material class. And here to mention is that if we go here to a composite formulation, like it is needed, then we can define the elastic domain at orthotropic or anisotropic behavior, and in the viscoplastic domain, we can define a Hill plasticity. So in that cases, we can define the composite dependent behavior are on the orientation or more on the direction. And to understand a little bit more, that for instance would be this material model MAT157. This is just the Hill plasticity, is just extended for Mises. If you look at this equation, you just get additional coefficients in here, which are necessary to scale this Mises sphere in different direction. So finally, you get to an ellipsoid by this Hill plasticity. As you see, the short fiber material looks a little bit different than ellipsoid, but with ellipsoid, I can better describe the anisotropy than with a sphere, as you can understand here. So what is needed here? If I look at this MAT157, I have different coefficients. And for instance, I can define an anisotropic stiffness. I can define this Hill plasticity coefficients. I can define some load curves describing the behavior also for the failure. And what I want to mention here, because it's quite important to know, that in that cases, the stiffness matrix, but also the Hill coefficients, are dependent of the fiber orientation. Please keep in mind, we have seen that on each element or each region in a real part, we have different fiber orientation. So we'll have a different stiffness dependent if the fiber is highly orientated, all fibers are in one direction, or it's getting more and more closer to an average orientation in the blade. So in that cases, you would need for each of these orientations a material card with different anisotropic stiffness and different Hill coefficients and so on, which makes it quite complicated on that point. What are other possibilities in LS-DYNA? Since the release R10, it's possible to also use a microscale approach with a homogenization. Here in this case, you differentiate between the matrix behavior, which you typically describe like a MAT24, isotropic, plastic, viscoplastic, and then you describe the fiber itself by an isotropic elastic behavior. And by this mean field homogenization, you finally can then describe the composite. And that would be available if with this MAT250, which was developed by 4A and implemented by Dynamo in LS-DYNA. So microscale approaches have quite interesting features too, because if we look at the failure back, you can perhaps remember this slide from last time. We can say failure criteria can differentiate between stress-based criteria and strain-based criteria. In case of composites, you typically would work on the stress-based field. But if you use a micromechanical motivated failure criteria, the big advantage would be that we, through the mean field homogenization, we can differentiate between the stresses and strains in the fiber and in the matrix. And so we can define a fiber failure, for instance, on the stress side for critical fiber stress. And on the matrix side, we can define the failure behavior on a typical ductile failure like a DM model, which is normally in LS-DYNA available. As you see, if you do that, for instance, in this banding test, you see here this history variables. On the left side, you see the fiber damage on this point. As you see, we are around 10%. So the fiber is mainly not used fully. Only 10% of its potential is used. On the other side, at the same deflection, we see that we are around 80% of the damage initiation of the matrix. So the matrix will soon fail, and based on the starting matrix failure, the whole sample will finally fail. So as you can see here, the big advantage of using a micromechanical approach would be that you then finally see what is, where's the failure coming from, for instance. Another advantage here, which I wanted to talk about, is if you want to take the fiber, the process simulation into account. So typically you then do a process simulation, where you get the fiber orientation tensor on each element. And this can be done with different simulation packages like they mentioned here. And then you can map this information to the structural mesh. In case of using a micro scale approach, the model directly understands the fiber orientation because it's an input of the material model. On the other side, on the macro scale side, you just need additional software which translates the information of the fiber orientation into, for instance, a composite stiffness or Hill coefficient, as the composite itself is needed here, the composite definition. And that makes it more complicated on that side, but on the other side, this model will be fast in the computational performance. Do you have any questions until here? Okay. So now I would like to go further to the next topic, how to make a material card for these material classes, MAT 157 and MAT 250. First of all, the next slide, I often get this question, why we don't use tension tests only to calibrate these material models. And therefore, I would like to have a short view on a sample. So if you do injection molding, as we can see, we have such a fish plug, which is injection molded here on this position. And as you see for different materials, short fiber 30%, fiber content, long fiber 30%, long fiber 60%. If we make these plugs and then we measure the fiber orientation, we will typically see that in this plate region, on here the surface, in the skin area, we have highly orientated fibers in this fiber direction, in this flow direction, in the center, in the core of the sample. The fibers are transversal orientated, so they are transversal to the flow direction. In this region here, where the flow is going together, we have a highly orientated region because the shear flow is dominating and all fibers are orientated in flow direction. So as you see, even in such a sample, we have different regions and it's quite hard to handle that. But thinking about what I mentioned already, depending on the fiber orientation, the mechanical properties are dependent. And if we look at this skin core effect, if we do a tensile test, we will always research an average behavior. And in that case, it's quite challenging to extrapolate the material behavior if you calibrate the material model, because you have only, you're limited because you get values of averaged fiber orientation over the thickness. In case if you're using bending tests, you are mainly research in the test on the skin layer. And in that reason, you get information on highly orientated skin layer if you test it in longitudinal direction, or you get information on the stiffness or other properties if you test the bending in bending test in transversal direction. So in these two cases, it's more easy to interpolate in between these fiber orientation behaviors. So how could a typical approach look like to get a mature cut from the test. So at 4E, we typically test different bending tests for different orientations. So it could be 0, 45, or 30, and 90 degree direction, where we cut out samples and do static and dynamic bending tests. And as you can see here, the failure, the longitudinal direction fails earlier than. So if you see here now, see that the longitudinal direction is failing earlier than the 45 degree transversal direction. And as you see, in transversal direction, gets at some micro cracks getting here, which shows that the matrix is failing, and then later on get into the total failure. So for that reasons, these bending tests are quite interesting. Additionally, to predict the failure behavior, we also like to conduct these puncture tests. Quite interesting, you have initial crack and the crack propagation, and that is quite challenging also to take this into account. As you see here, we have here some, that's the force displacement, we get additional energy to the crack propagation here. So now, how to get MUT 215 or 157 out of this process? So if you want to use a micromechanical approach, you need additional information. On the one side, you need information on the fiber, the information of the mechanical properties, fiber content, the aspect ratio, meaning the length ratio to thickness ratio, and about the fiber orientation. So mechanical properties of fibers you typically find in literature. Fiber content is something you know normally, which because you purchased this material. Aspect ratio and fiber orientation you can do with engineering judgment. You know about, is it short fiber? How is it orientated, for instance? Or you can do additional tests, for instance, on the fiber orientation, make a micro CT and look at the local fiber orientation. For the matrix, as we are using an mean field approach, the matrix behavior is an average matrix behavior. So we have local maxima of the matrix around the fiber, and we describe but here an average behavior. So that's why I call this a pseudo-mechanical properties. So you need the yield, the hardening, a failure, and so on. And these are values you typically get out, especially from the hardening and the failure from reverse engineering, for instance, with our software Valimat and LSOpt. And finally, to do this, you need tests. As already mentioned, you can use bending tests and additionally tensile tests. For failure, it's good to also have puncture tests to research and biaxial behavior, and use needed, as we have seen, static and dynamic tests to get a good crash cut, because this is strain rate dependent. But how is the step-by-step approach here? So I have an example here, which a consortium of research project provided this information to us. So they gave us some plugs, some samples, and so on. And these were a polyamide impact modified with 30% gas fiber in it, with different moisture contents, dry, conditioned, and wet. And for these plugs, we also got the fiber orientation measurement, as you see, also quite nice here. We see the standard deviation of the measurement and the average curve. So we see highly orientated in the skin, a small core area, and we see this fiber orientation. We conducted different tests at 4E. Here you can see the influence. Bending test, transversal, longitudinal direction at 3 meters per second, we see the dry is quite brittle and stiff, and as we're getting wetter and wetter, we're getting more ductile in case of the wet, meaning roughly 5 or 8% water in the sample. They're quite ductile and even get no failure. You can also see this in the puncture test. So you see the brittle failure behavior for the dry one. The failure increases initially from getting more conditioned, and in case of the wet, it's getting less stiff, and the failure is quite late. So quite interesting material because of these huge differences. So how we did the material calibration in here, the first step was, these assumptions. The fiber properties for glass was taken from the literature. The fiber content, we know it's 30%. We assumed the aspect ratio of 20. We took the average of the fiber orientation measurement, and then we simulated just the elastic region of the dynamic bending tests. And as you see, we could quite good predict it for the different direction for 0, 30, and 90 degree, quite good agreement. Do you have any questions until this point? So if not, then I will go further to the next step. So as already mentioned, in the next step, we have then to get the hardening low. Here we use a typical reverse engineering approach with Valimat, meaning we have a equation describing the hardening curve for the matrix. And we make a parameter identification for this equation. And if we do so, we take a static and the dynamic bending test in transversal direction, cut it out of a sample, and then having a function and getting closer and closer to both curves. And here you can see the final outcome for the different hardening curves for the dry version, for the static, and the dynamic, for the conditioned, static and dynamic, and for the wet, also static and dynamic. As you can see, here we get these hardening curves, and the next step is then to, after calibrating the hardening behavior of the matrix on the transversal direction, validate this, and finally get then the failure strains and validate this also on the puncture test to see if you get this initial failure point and if the energy consumption is same in the simulation as in the test. So the solid line is the simulation curve, and the dotted point is the average of the test curves. As you can see, we are in quite good agreement here. If we have, then here you can also see a picture of simulation, which also the crack is opening like in the test. If we look at the results for different behaviors like transversal bending tests, static and dynamic for dry and conditioned, dynamic bending test over the orientation 0, 30, and 90 degree for dry, conditioned, and wet, and seeing the dynamic puncture test for dry, conditioned, and wet, you see we can predict with this material model, but just having different matrix properties in it, considering the moisture content, that we can have a quite good agreement over all these tests, different conditions. Okay, do you have any further question?
Hello, may I ask
Ja.
This is Alper Taşdemirci from Turkey. Thank you
Hello.
very much for this. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you good.
Okay. Thank you very much for this nice presentation. As far as the material model parameter identification study is concerned, there are some parts that you are doing some reverse engineering or some trial and error like parameter identification studies. For most of the failure concerning simulations, they are mesh sensitive. How would you justify that those parameters are mesh insensitive? For example, the ones that you just showed us in the previous slide, the dynamic bending type of results.
Okay.
Thank you.
What I can mention here, the materials itself are more brittle in general. So the mesh sensitivity is, you don't will have a localization, which is mainly the reason why you are more mesh sensitive. So a big issue is the difference in the material cuts between shell and solid formulation, because the shell doesn't, is quite, for the shell element, it's quite challenging to describe the real behavior. But from my point of view, this mesh dependency is not so huge for this material class, as it's
okay.
material
okay.
behavior. That's different.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for the answer. I got it.
I also get the question, how is the conditioned sample prepared? I guess no ISO norm is set for this state. So there are some ISO norms that can be used. We have there's a fast approach we have used here. So you have to give it in some climate chamber for several days or weeks until you get a constant moisture content.
Thank you very much for the answer. Thank you again.
And the second question is, I have okay. What curve fitting criteria is used by Valimat? We can use the different options which are available in LSOPT. Normally we use a least square method and use the response surface methods to get the parameter identification. That works quite well for the typical material models. Okay. If there are no further questions, then I would go further in the presentation. So after getting this material class, it was quite interesting to getting more closer in this simulation process chain, taking the fiber orientation from the process simulation into the structure simulation. Keep in mind, this material cards were generated by assumption of the fiber orientation measurement. So we took an average fiber orientation, which we have measured, and it worked quite well. For next step, we have this injection mold. In this injection mold, we could produce different samples. So the calibration was done mainly on this plate. But we have also the possibility to mold this special black where you can investigate on melt and weld lines. And as you can see, we have then done, our partner have done some injection molding simulations of this plate. As you can see, it's quite a straight filling. In case of the weld lines, we see the different weld lines, how they will develop. And this can be researched and tested. So the first step was then look into this plate. And as you can see here now, this fiber orientation, we have the fiber orientation as a contour plot here. So red is highly orientated, blue is less orientated. And as we can see, green is average orientated here. And if we look in here, that was the measurement. And as you can see, we don't can get this region here. It's quite challenging to get this simulation result similar from the MolDX simulation, but also other process simulation close to the reality. So what does this affect in the structural prediction? So next step, we then took the fiber orientation, mapped it on the banding samples, as you see, to the mapping procedure. As we have no core fibers in the core layer, which are transversal in the mapping, also all fibers are in this longitudinal direction. So we have no core layer in it. And as you see, then we simulated it, and by scaling mainly the hardening curve by 20%, we even could then predict it. So we had to adjust the material card because of the whole simulation process chain. Meaning, if you finally want to take this into account with the fiber orientation coming from the process simulation, you always have to make the material calibration on the whole simulation process chain if you want to get the local anisotropy into account. Interesting was then also to simulate the weld lines here. As you can see, we have a region of this area. We have this melt line, and by scaling the failure strength to 30%, we could even predict that quite well. And using the same value for this weld line here, as you see, then we have a bigger region of interest here. We even could predict this quite brittle behavior with 30% failure strength. So, as you see, with such a micromechanical approach, it's quite easy to just adjust your values based on if you have some weld lines or if you take these fibers into account. That's the big advantage of a micromechanical approach. So now have back a look on this case study. And if we look at this case study, we did also the mold filling here. Our partner did it, and as you see, we have this fiber orientation, and the test was conducted, and remember, in the test, it fails here in the middle. The isotropic approach brings us to a failure, which is total on a different location, and if we simulate it with MUT-157 and 250, in both cases, by just using direction induced by the orientation tensor, you already get this behavior described quite well. To quantify this more in values, here you can also see the test. This is the red curves. These are the test curves. And here you see the result of this MUT-24 card. And the orange curve, that's the outcome of this anisotropic approach. This was not done with the last calibration, so please keep in mind, we told that this has to be scaled with 20%. So this was done with the primular material cards I showed. So by scaling this also to the 20%, we came quite close to the real behavior. And we did this also for the dry ones and the conditioned ones. And as you see, generally, we can quite good describe all this behavior in these tests. Okay, so this was the first part on the short fiber reinforced materials. Do you have any questions on that before we go finally to composite? So if not, then I will go over to the next material class, the composites. So with this material class, I mainly mean the real high these composites which you know with carbon, with 60% volume content fiber in it, with endless fibers or woven material. This glass is meant by that. And typically here, if we look in this region, we can do different tests. Normally there are lots of standards in it, which you can get static tests typically under tension. So you do normally tensile tests in unidirectional direction or with multi-layer layup with multi-direction. You do this normally with different orientations. So research in this region, that's normally standard. What we additionally offer is the research under bending tests. That's quite interesting because you also get information on the manufacturing influence. And we can do this also dynamic, because with Impetus we can do the static and dynamic tests. So for instance, here you can see the failure of a CFRP at longitudinal direction. The next would be under transversal direction. You see you don't have many resistance against the impact, which is quite well known. And here you can also see an impact behavior of such a multi-layer layup or a woven material. So what material models are available? And here you see there are lots of material models available, and all of this mainly are based on the same. You have elastic behavior, which is autotropic, and then you can, there's no plasticity model in it because the materials are highly filled, and typically you use elastic behavior and couple this with a damage model. This damage model can be more complex, or this damage failure model can be more complex and can also include the strain dependency or not. As you see, then you can even go to this advanced models like Bino, Amanio, which are based on this book criterias, or those one which are not so high sophisticated, which are more known because they are easier to use in the CS softwares, which is based on Saivu criteria or Hill or something like that. So how can you get the material cut with Valimat for these composites? Here in Valimat, we have also this micromechanical approach included. So you just choose the first state, the material model. So as you see, we have these material models available in our software. And in the area of deteriorization, you switch from a normal part to a part composite, and then you can set up your material model. And as you can see, we can then define the matrix properties, the filler properties, the orientation, and the strengths. And this can be used for this composite. And yeah, in that case, we don't do really reverse engineering. Here we just adjust these values and simulate it, and then get a good, hopefully a good agreement with the test result. To mention here, one of the most important things to look at is the density. So the density of the specimen shows you how much fiber in it. Often, it's not like that the values you get from the supplier for the material manufacturer are like 100%. So often through the manufacturing process, perhaps you have 4-5% less fiber in it locally in your samples. And that should be used in your calibration. And especially here, this can be seen in the density. So the first look, what we always do is if the rule of mixture in the density is correct by using the density of the resin, using the density of the fiber. And if this suits, then normally all, everything else is also working. So that sounds strange. It's really quite easy assumption, and that works quite well. So then we have our parameters in our material cards. That's a look like format 22, just a simple one. And as you see, all these values, what we have in here, are directly coming from this micromechanical approach. So we don't need this, these are used constant. So we have no need to invoke a reverse engineering procedure here. This can be then used later on if you go to more complex models, which are looking more on the failure side. So as you can see, we can quite good predict this material with this approach. You see the test curves and the simulation can quite good describe the behavior of this material class in the bending tests for the static and also static and dynamic. And you can also make research in Valimat on different idealizations. For instance, if you use such stacked layer approach, you have to keep you have to have a closer look and in the layer between in the contact formulation that this is working fine, that this is not, this stiffness in this contact formulation is not disturbing your material behavior. And then it's also possible to get this step by step failure, what you see the real test described in your simulation. If you do all this, here we also have a case study. This is a front hood, which is made of a composite top layer with a honeycomb core in it. And if you do then such an impact test with a head and shoot it to the front hood and we simulate it, then you see we get a quite good agreement in this test too between test and simulation, which should show that this approach is working quite well. If you're interested more in that, here's then a link to the paper where you can have a closer look at that. So today we have talking, or the last two parts, we've talking about thermoplastics and fiber reinforced plastics and composites. I want to summarize this. So today we have talking about this material classes. We have seen that for composites, which have a higher fiber content, we need typical material models which can describe the elastic and damage behavior. For short and long fiber materials, which have a medium fiber content, so meaning fiber content volume content about 20%, we should also take the viscoplasticity into account of the matrix. There are two main approaches in the simulation. We can use the macro scale, so describing the composite behavior, or we can use the micro scale to distinguish between fiber and resin matrix behavior. The main difference is the micro scale gives you more flexibility, and on the other side, the macro scale is better in the computational effort. Yeah, finally, I think to summarize, LS Dyna offers you lots of tools to simulate thermoplastics and fiber reinforced materials. But always keep in mind, there are lots of influences of these material classes, like anisotropy, viscosity, temperature, and moisture. And please focus on that topics, what are necessary for your application, because otherwise you will not find, it's lots of work to do all this testing, and it's quite challenging to bring all this information into one model. And I think an engineering approach is to focus on the main issue you have, and then you will finally end up with a good material model. If you need tools to handle all this data and to fit complex models, I showed you our software Valimat, and you can also use our testing device Impetus for service at 4A or our partners, or clearly, if you are interested in, you can also buy these products. And if you're interested in more on that, save the date for our summer school. Would be a pleasure. And yeah, thanks you for your attention. And if you have any further questions, answer it now.
Okay, thank you, Peter, for this nice talk. And actually, yeah, there is a question, very last one. I'm not sure if you can answer it right now, but please, can you give more information on MUD27, the Mooney Rivlin rubber? I think it's 127.
Yeah, MUD20. We can have a separate webinar on on this.
Okay, so we already have the next topic then, right?
Yeah, we have this topic and also this topic. So, because I would say it could be a whole webinar on rubbers. There are lots of models also for rubbers and also for foams. Perhaps a topic rubber and foams. All these hyperelastic and viscoelastic models which are available in Elastina. Interesting.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello. I'm Majid Kulkarni. The question which I asked for the MUD27. Actually, I would like to know that for the MUD27 that what kind of physical testing and what kind of data, that is A factor and the B factor, could be used in the MUD27. Means in like MUD24, we do the simple tension test and we'll give the load curve, stress strain curve. For that, so in case of MUD27, how we can replicate the test data in the MUD27, or which test should be recommended to the designer for the Mooney Rivlin? Means like a rubber material.
Yeah, the Mooney Rivlin is the simplest one of the rubber models, and therefore you need not lots of tests because it's mainly nearly like elastic. So it's a little non-linearity, and in that case you should do some compression tests. If your load case is in compression, if your load case is in tension, you should do some tension tests. But this model allows you not so lots of opportunities. There are other models like the Otkin model or some hyperelastic models where you have additional so this is a two-parameter model to describing the stress strain curve, or more the stretch to stress behavior. If you go for Otkin, you can describe even more nonlinearity. So in that cases, you should do a test close to your real tests to use the simple model.
Okay. Okay.
So if you have a compression application, please use a compression test. If it's the application close to tensile, please use a tensile test. That's what I wanted to tell.
Okay, okay.
Okay, are there any more questions? Some more? Doesn't seem to be the case. So I think I'm closing the session then.